Hello students, in this lecture we are going to learn about the different type of centrifugation. What are the prerequisites for this lecture? You all understand the type of rotors, concept of direction of RCF in different type of rotors, and the concept of pallet, supernatant, rotor speed and RCF. Rotor speed is always taken as a RPM, that is revolution per minute. RCF is the relative centrifugal field. This is a property that has no unit, because this is the ratio of applied centrifugal field with the gravity force. After this lecture, you will be able to know what are the types of centrifuges and what are the different type of centrifugation and their applications. Just have a little animation, then I will discuss the different type of centrifuges and centrifugation techniques. So enjoy this animation. You can see this is an example of zonal ultracentrifugation that you are going to learn in the today's lecture. This is the stabilizing sucrose gradient. Gradient means the density of sucrose differ from top to bottom and in increasing order. See, you can see we have lesser density of sucrose over here and larger density of sucrose over here. Now we will subject our sample at the top of the tube, and then for the spin at a predefined RCF, the slow sedimenting component will remain here and the fast sedimenting component will move down. Then we will further fractionate the mixture. What will we do in fractionation method? We will just have different pallet in different tubes. Suppose these are the component which are fast sedimenting component. So we will get the pallet of such type of component at the start of the operation. Then we will transfer that component into a test tube and subject the rest of the solution for further centrifugation. Then after, we will get different density fraction. We'll separate that different density fraction into the another test tube either by breaking down the bottom or by transferring the rest of the supernatant into the next tube. Then we will subject the supernatant for further cycles. In such a way, we will get pure form of our fractions in different test tubes. Now coming to the different type of centrifuges. Basically, the centrifuges are divided into three categories: desktop centrifuges, high speed centrifuges and ultra centrifuges. Ultra centrifuges are further divided into two: analytical and preparative. They are differ from each other in terms of their RCF, RPM and applications, as well as their size and other facilities. Now, desktop centrifuge. You can see here the picture of desktop centrifuge. This is a simple type of centrifuge which is very simple and small in size. The maximum speed of rotor for this centrifuges are 300 rpm. They do not have any temperature regulatory system and generally used to collect rapidly sedimenting substances such as blood cell, yeast cell or bulky precipitates of chemical reactions. Now the second category is high speed centrifuges. If we compare the efficiency of centrifuges, the high speed centrifuges exist somewhere in between ultra centrifuges and desktop centrifuges. They have maximum speed of 25000 rpm, providing 90,000 g centrifugal forces, where g is the gravity force. Means gravity force multiplied by 90,000 will be the overall centrifugal force that exists on the particle. These type of centrifuges are equipped with refrigeration to remove heat generated while operation. Temperature in this type of centrifuges are maintained at the degree of 0 to 4 by means of thermocouples. These are used to collect microorganisms, cell debris, cells, large cellular organelles, precipitates of chemical reaction. These type of centrifuges are also useful in isolating the subcellular organelles like nuclei, mitochondria and lysosomes. Coming to the advanced and very important type of centrifuges, that are ultra centrifuges. As the name indicated, they are very much efficient when we compare this with the desktop as well as high speed centrifuges. They can operate at the speed of 75,000 rpm and may provide the centrifugal force of 5 lakh g. The rotor chamber in such type of centrifuges, you can see here, are sealed and evacuated by pump to attain the vacuum. The refrigeration system also exists in such type of centrifuges that also maintain the temperature from 0 to 4 degrees centigrade. The rotor chamber is always enclosed in a heavy armor plate. You can see here, this is a heavy armor plate. It is also have a hardware unit that is associated with the software system, and we can operate these type of centrifuges by input different type of RPM or RCM. The centrifugation or for isolation and purification of components is known as preparatory centrifugation, while that carried out with a desire for characterization is known as analytical centrifugation. I am again repeating, centrifugation for isolation and purification of component which are known to us. Suppose we have a mixture of mitochondria, chloroplast, nucleic acid, and we have to separate that three components using centrifugation technique, then this type of centrifugation is known as the preparative centrifugation. Whereas suppose we have a mixture of unknown components, and then when we carried out the centrifugation, then that will known as the analytical centrifugation, because such centrifugation is used for analytical purpose. Now coming to the preparative centrifugation, means where we know the mixture is made up of so and so components, right? The preparative centrifugation is concerned with the actual isolation of biological material for subsequent biochemical investigations. This preparative centrifugation is again divided into two categories. First is used for homogeneous medium, and that is known as the differential centrifugation. Whereas the another one is used for density gradient medium and known as the density gradient centrifugation. Now coming to the detail of differential centrifugation. The differential centrifugation is based upon the differences in the sedimentation rate of biological particle of different size. Crude tissue homogenate that contains organelles, membrane vesicles and other structural fragments are divided into different fractions step by step by increasing the applied centrifugal field. Initially, the sedimentation of the larger particle of the homogenate takes place by centrifugation, and for this mixture we have cellular debris as the largest particle. Then after, various biological structure or aggregates are separated into pellet and supernatant fractions that depends on the speed and type of individual centrifugation step and the density and relative size of the particle. The differential sedimentation of a particular suspension in a centrifugal field is dramatically shown below in the next slide. Initially, all particles of the homogenate are evenly distributed throughout the centrifuge tube and then move down the tube at their respective sedimentation rate during centrifugation. The largest class of particles form a pellet on the bottom, of the centrifuge tube, leaving smaller size structures within the supernatant. And at the end of the differential centrifugation step, the pellet and supernatant fraction are carefully transferred in the different tubes and get separated from each other. Now let's understand differential centrifugation using this pictorial representation. See, during centrifugation, larger particles sediments faster than the smaller one, that we have already learned in the basic principle of sedimentation and centrifugation. At a series of progressive higher G force generate partially purified organelles. What happened actually in the differential centrifugation, you can see here in the picture. See, this is a first picture in which we have taken the cell homogenate. Homogenate means it is a homogeneous mixture of different cell organelles. Okay, then we will start our centrifugation process. During first spin, what will happen? The largest particle will form pellet first. Then what we'll do? We will separate the supernatant into the another tube and get separated the pellet one. Generally, the largest particle in the homogenate is whole cell nuclei or cytoskeleton. Then the supernatant first will again subjected to the spin 2. In this case, we have increased the sedimentation rate by increasing the speed of rotor. What will happen? The second largest particle form pellet. Over here you can see we will transfer the supernatant into the third test tube and we will get separated the second largest particle. Here the example has been given as mitochondria, lysosomes or peroxisomes. Then during the third spin, we will get the third largest particle as a pellet, and finally we will get the fourth largest, or you can say the smallest particle at the last operation. Now, what are the advantages and disadvantages of differential centrifugation? In spite of its reduced yield, differential centrifugation remains probably the most commonly used method for the isolation of intercellular organelles from tissue homogenates. This is because of its relative ease, means they are easy to handle, they are convenient to carry in the lab, and they are economical in terms of time. The main drawback which is associated with the differential centrifugation is its poor yield and fact that preparation obtained never pure, because if we remember, we in the previous slide we have seen that we are getting the mixture of two or three components, so we cannot get exactly or highly pure fractions using differential centrifugation. Now coming to the second type of ultra centrifugation, that is density gradient centrifugation. This is a method where the components of a sample, for example DNA, are separated on the basis of their density in a centrifuge according to the centrifugal force they experience. To further separate biological particles of similar size but different density, ultra centrifugation performed, and this is a self-established density gradient method of choice. A mixture of particles such as is present in a heterogeneous microsomal membrane preparation is layered on the top of a performed liquid density gradient. Cesium chloride is widely used for the bending of DNA and the isolation of plasmids, nucleoprotein and viruses. Sodium bromide and sodium iodide are employed for the fractionation of lipoproteins and the bending of DNA or RNA molecules respectively. If one wants to separate all membrane species spanning the whole range of particle densities, the maximum density of the gradient must exceed the density of the most dense vesicle species. Gradients are usually kept in a cold room for temperature equilibration and are moved extremely slowly in special holders so as to avoid mixing of different gradient layers. For rate separation of subcellular particles, the required fraction does not reach its isopycnic position within the gradient. I will explain this isopycnic and rate zonal term further. For isopycnic separation, the density gradient centrifugation is continued until the biodensity of the particle of interest and the density of the gradients are equal. This is a preferred method to purify subcellular organelles and macromolecules. As I told you that I will explain dead zonal and isopycnic density gradient centrifugation. So understand that the density gradient centrifugation is further divided into two types, the dead zonal separation or the isopycnic. In density gradient centrifugation, the common gradient material used are sucrose, that is 66% at 5 degree centigrade, silica salts, glycerol, cesium chloride, cesium acetate, phycol, sorbitol and polyvinyl pyrrolidone. Now, coming to the types of density gradient ultracentrifugation, the first one is red zonal density gradient ultracentrifugation. The red zonal centrifugation can be understood in the way that in a red zonal, the solution have density gradient. Density gradient means difference in the density from top to bottom in a sample tube, and the sample has density which has greater than all the layer in the solution. Means the overall, the average density of the sample should be greater than the density of all layer of the solution. Thus, the sample is applied in a thin zone at the top of the centrifuge tube. Under centrifugal force, the particle will begin to separate according to their zones, that are the density gradient. The particle will sediment in separate zones according to their shape and size. Now, I will try to explain the red zonal density gradient centrifugation using this figure. You can see this is a sample tube. This is the sample. This is the sample zone where we have to cap the mixture of sample. You can see different numeric value has been given and different zones. Here you can see 1.1 gram per milliliter has been given, then 1.2, 1.3 and so on, means the density of the solution is getting increased from top to bottom, right? Now here we have a sample that has different type of component. When we run our centrifugation process, what will happen? The sample, suppose this is the round black particle, okay? These particles have density similar to this zone. This is 1.2 gram per milliliter. So what will happen? These rounded black particle will stay in this zone only, whereas the heavier or the larger density particle will move downwards and stay on the zone where it matches the density of the solution. In this way, we will get separated the mixture on the basis of their different density at different zones of solution. Now the next type is isopycnic density gradient ultracentrifugation. As the name indicated, isopycnic means density will be remain constant throughout the solution from top to bottom, and the sample through this technique gets separated on their equilibrium position. Each molecule floats or sinks to its equivalent density position. Now let's understand the isopycnic ultracentrifugation or the isopycnic density gradient ultracentrifugation with the help of this figure. See, in this test tube we have a solution of a particular density, but the density of the solution is same throughout the medium from top to bottom, right? We have a different component in a mixture that has different density. Some component may have density less than the medium, some may have density equal to the medium, and some have density more than the medium. Then what will happen when we run the centrifugation? The particles that have lesser density than the medium will float at the top of the tube. The particles that have almost similar density to that of the medium will float in the middle of the test tube, whereas the particle that has more density than the medium will sink down at the bottom of the tube. In this way, we will get different layer of component on the basis of different densities, and then we will get final separation of the particles. Now on this slide, we have some differences of red zonal and isopycnic density gradient centrifugation. The synonym of dead zonal centrifugation is azonal or sedimentation velocity. Means you may get question as a dead zonal, as a azonal, as a sedimentation velocity. All the three terms are same. Same for isopycnic. This is also known as the density equilibrium and sedimentation equilibrium. Now gradient. In case of dead zonal, we have shallow gradient. Maximum gradient density less than the least dense sedimenting species, and the gradient continuous. Continuous means if the gradient is increasing from top to bottom. So we have lesser density zone at top and highest density at the bottom. We cannot have a random density. Suppose we have 1 at first position, 4 at second, and 2 at third. This is not allowed. Either we have density like 1, 2, 3 or 3 to 1. Whereas in isopycnic gradient, the gradient is steep. Maximum gradient density greater than that of the most dense sedimentating species. This may be continuous or discontinuous. Centrifugation is incomplete sedimentation. This involves low time and low speed and short time. Whereas isopycnic is a complete sedimentation till equilibrium is achieved. This is high speed and long time. Using dead zonal, we can separate RNA-DNA hybrids and ribosomal subunits. Whereas using isopycnic density gradient ultracentrifugation, we can separate DNA, plasma lipoprotein, lysosomes, and mitochondria. Now coming to the last type, that is analytical centrifugation. The speed of analytical centrifugation is 70,000 rpm. RCF is 5 lakh g. These have motor, rotor, chamber that is refrigerated and evacuated, and this is also mounted with the optical system. Optical system has light absorption system, Sclerian system, and Rayleigh interferometric system. This has two cells, analytical cells and counterpoise cell. Now let's understand this analytical centrifugation by this diagram. This is the xenon flash lamp, and this is an aperture. Okay, this is a concave mirror, this is a reflective mirror, this is a incident light detector, this is a cell, this is a Now let's understand the working of analytical centrifugation. This is a source, xenon flash lamp. This is a slit through which a small thin rays of light will allow to pass. This is a concave mirror used to reflect the light into this direction. This is a reflector. This reflector refracts some rays of light to the incident light detector. This light detector detects the intensity or wavelength of light before passing through the sample or reference cell. This is a chamber that has reference cell assembly as well as sample cell assembly. Reference means the assembly that has known sample, that may be either mitochondria or nucleic acid or anything, right? Whereas in this sample assembly, we don't know what has been given. What will happen? First, we will allow to pass these light rays through the reference cell. Okay, first we have the intensity of light as it is. Then we will allow to pass the light through the known solution. Then we will allow to pass the light through the sample solution. We will have some change in the intensity of the light from original, from the light that passed through the reference, and then the light that passed through the sample. In this way, we can detect what type of cell organelles has been taken as a sample by comparing the light intensities of reference as well as sample. And how will we compare? We will only compare the decrease in the intensity of light when we compare the intensity of real light before passing through the reference, and then we will check the decrease in the light when the light passed through the sample, and then we will compare both the decreases and we'll find whether the sample or the reference are same or different. Analytical centrifugation are generally used to find out the purity of macromolecule, to find out the relative molecular mass of the solute within 5% standard deviation, used to find out the change in the relative molecular mass of the supermolecule complexes, used to find out the conformational change of protein structure, and for the ligand binding species. This is the comparison of different type of centrifuges, desktop, high speed or ultra centrifuges. You can see here on the basis of speed, desktop centrifuge has speed of 1 to 6000, high speed has 1000 to 25000, whereas the ultra has 20 to 80000. Maximum RCF 6000 in case of desktop, 50000 in case of high speed, and 6 lakh in case of ultra centrifuges. Refrigeration is absent in desktop whereas present in high speed and ultra centrifugation. And these are the applications: desktop, high speed and ultra centrifuges all can be used for pelleting of cells, for pelleting of nuclei, whereas the desktop centrifuges are failed for the pelleting of organelles, pelleting of ribosomes and pelleting of macromolecules. The pelleting of ribosomes and pelleting of macromolecules are not possible also using high speed centrifuges. So these are the applications. In clinical laboratory, centrifugation is used to remove cellular elements from blood to provide cell-free plasma and serum for analysis. Remove chemically precipitated protein from an analytical specimen. Separate protein bound from free ligand in immunochemical and other assay. Separation of the subcellular organelle DNA and RNA. Extract solutes in biological fluids from aqueous to organic solvent and used to separate lipid components. These are the references from where I have taken material for this lecture. Thank you for your patience.